Good morning to all of you. Well, you know, I just love our church, don't you? The baptism celebrations were truly amazing. The oldest person to get baptized last weekend, she was 90 years old. Isn't that great? I just love that. And then, of course, we had some really young ones. I think the youngest one was 8 years old. Sherry had a stroke 2 weeks before, but she came up and said she could barely get up the stairs and into the pool, but she said, I want to do this. Tammy said she had taken a shot for some allergic reaction she had, and she had an allergic reaction from the shot. She could barely walk, and she got into the pool and got baptized. In fact, today's Tammy's birthday. I think today's Rachel's birthday who's here. It's so many great things, and I just love what we're doing here at South Bay Community Church, what you're a part of, what I get to be a part of. And, you know, it's considering all that's happening in the world today, I think that what we're doing here is the most important thing that we could possibly ever do with our lives. I hope that you feel that. I feel that. I have a sense of hope about everything because we have Jesus Christ, because we get to do what we do, because we get to share the good news with others. And so I hope that you'll constantly keep that in mind, again, as things are happening. I don't know if you heard, but this morning in San Francisco, there was an earthquake, a 6.1 earthquake. And it has been pretty quiet on Facebook because I think that the power, for the most part, is out and people can't communicate. Hopefully, everyone is safe. And I know that many of you have family members and friends up there. So I wanted to come up here. I'm beginning this service a little bit differently than I began last evening's service because of that earthquake. And so I just want to ask all of you to pray for that. Let's just pray for that, and let's just ask God to bless our time together as well. All right, let's pray together. Father, we come before you this morning. Our hearts are just filled with so much gratitude for all that you have been doing here at this church. Father, to see 34 people get baptized, in fact, over the last 15 months, to see 110 people get baptized here, is just the greatest thrill that we could ever be a part of, helping people find and follow you, have a relationship with you. Father, in these very difficult days, as we'll hear a little bit about in this message, God, our hope comes from you. I know people in this room, this very room, are struggling with all kinds of health issues, perhaps financial issues, perhaps marital issues. Father, it's so good to know that we have hope in you. No matter what happens, you're always there for us and you love us. And Father, this morning we come as a church to lift up our family and friends, especially our family and friends in San Francisco, in that San Francisco Bay Area, Father, as they've been struck by a very large earthquake. And we ask, God, for your presence to be there, that you would watch and care for, especially those that we know and we love. And Father, that somehow throughout this, and we know that could have been a whole lot worse, but even through this experience for all those people in the Bay Area, Father, we pray that on this Sunday morning, their hearts would turn to you, that people would look to you, that churches would be filled up because of the realization that life is very short and that they need you. So, Father, do that work in San Francisco. Do work in us. Father, today I ask that you would speak to every single one of us. I pray you'd speak to me. Father, we ask that your words would become alive and that you would give us ears to hear, that we would be changed by what we learn here today. So thank you, Father, so much. Bless our time today. Ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, everyone, take a look at the screen.
Funny. Very funny. Oh, thank you. Flowers. Oh, Ricky, you shouldn't have.
I didn't.
You didn't? Oh, no, these are for you.
For me?
Who's sending you flowers?
Get well quick, laugh. Jim and Dorothy, I feel fine.
Oh, I know. I didn't want to go to dinner with Jim and Dorothy Wynn tonight, so I told them that you sprained your ankle. There's another one. Oh, now, what's the matter with that? That's just a little social fib.
Honey, you knew that we were going to have dinner with the Mercers. Why didn't you just tell them the truth?
You can't tell people the truth. They think you're lying. You have to lie to make them think you're telling the truth.
Well, it's not funny. You got to cut it out.
Now, Ricky, don't be too tough on Lucy.
Thanks, Fred.
She can't help it if she's a liar.
Wow. Well, old Fred didn't mean it like that. He just means the colorful way you push the truth around is part of your character.
Yeah, Molly McGee should have such a fibber.
Oh, I think you're all just horrid. I could tell the absolute truth like everybody else if I wanted to be dull. Present company not accepted.
Honey, you couldn't tell the absolute truth if your whole life depended on it.
Would you like to risk a little money on that proposition?
I most certainly would. I'll tell you what. I'll bet you that you can't tell the truth for
how long? 1 week?
I'll make it easy on you. 1 day. 24 hours.
Okay.
How much you want to bet?
Make it easy on yourself. Any part of $100?
I'll take it all.
Can I have a piece of that?
I'd like a little of that, too.
My friends.
Oh, it hasn't anything to do with friendship. It's just that there are so few sure ways of making a buck these days.
I'll tell you what. I'll take 50 and I'll give you each 25.
Five.
Thank you.
When do you want to start?
It's 1 minute to 8. I'll start on the hour.
Okay. You got yourself a bet.
Okay. Did I ever tell you the time that Cary Grant asked me to marry him? Hasn't started yet. I just thought I'd have one last fib for the road. Okay, it started for the next 24 hours.
Okay.
All right.
I can hardly wait to hear you tomorrow afternoon, Lucy.
Why?
We're playing bridge at Carolyn's, remember?
Oh, no, no, no. I can't spend the afternoon with three women and have to tell the truth. I'll call Carolyn and tell her I'm sick.
I love Lucy. Don't you love Lucy? One of my favorite sitcoms of all time. And you're probably coming to church for the first time and wondering, what are they doing showing I Love Lucy for? What's that all about? Well, you know what? I wanted to use that kind of segue into what we want to talk about today. Do you have a hard time telling the truth? You have a hard time telling the truth? If you made a bet with somebody and said, I could tell the truth in 24 hours, and I bet I can't tell a lie, would you win that bet? Or would you lose that bet? You know, sadly, we live in a culture in which our culture is based entirely upon lies. In fact, our entire world is built upon lies. Now, think about this. Everybody lies. It seems that everybody lies. Parents lie to their children, and children lie to their parents, and children lie to their teachers, and teachers lie to their children, and coaches and workers lie to their bosses, and bosses lie to their workers, and husbands lie to their wives, and wives lie to their husbands, and lawyers lie, and doctors lie, and mechanics lie, and business people lie, and reporters lie, athletes lie, celebrities lie, salespeople lie, friends lie, church people lie, rich people lie, poor people lie, leaders lie, politicians lie. In fact, that one is really true. I mean, the United States, just recently, just earlier this month, a sitting United States senator from the state of Montana had to give up his reelection campaign because he was caught in a lie. He had plagiarized a paper for his master's degree. And so he lied, and so they forced him to withdraw from the race. He will not be a senator at the end of the year. And it's kind of the point where, especially with our politicians, it's kind of the point where we assume automatically they're going to lie. And we can assume that they're not going to tell the truth. And that it is a sad day when it's come to that. Well, you know, this summer, we've been studying through the book of Ephesians in a series called Who Do You Think You Are? Because that's what Ephesians is all about. It's about who we are in Jesus Christ. The book is divided into six chapters, but it's divided into three sections. The first three chapters, 1, 2, and 3, are all about who we are in Christ. And then the second section, chapters 4, 5, and 6, are all about how we live because of who we are. And that's what Ephesians is all about. Well, last week we learned that in order to be like the new creation that we are, then we need to strip off some of the old things in our lives. We need to strip off the old and put on the new in order to be the people that God created us to be. You see, too often, who we are on the inside doesn't line up and doesn't match up with how we live on the outside. And so we got to strip off the old and put on the new. Well, today we come to the final 8 verses of chapter 4. And as he's done throughout this entire chapter, throughout this entire book, Paul gets very, very practical here. He gets very practical here. And in this section, Paul instructs us on 5 ways on five ways that we as Christ followers need to live. Five things, five characteristics that ought to embody every believer. And Paul does this. He teaches this to us by, first of all, telling us about five don'ts. Don't do this, five. And then he gives us five do's, five commands. Do this. So don't do this, but do this. And so he gives us a contrast. And then he also, at the end of the contrast, after the fifth after the positive command that he gives us, he tells us how, he explains why it is that we need to live out that positive command. So that's what I want you to look for as we go through this section here today. And you have a sheet in your Baywatch with all the verses listed, Ephesians chapter 4. You want to pull it out or turn to Ephesians chapter 5 or chapter 4 in your Bible. But again, look for this. There are five negative traits, and then it's followed by five positive commands. So don't do this, but do this, and then an explanation as to why you ought to live out that positive command. So take a look at Ephesians chapter 4. And starting in verse 25, and let me read it to you, and then we'll get into the message. Here's what Paul wrote. He said, "Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. And give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need." Verse 29, "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you." May God bless the preaching of his word. You know, the first topic that Paul addresses in this issue is the issue of lying and of telling the truth. If you take a look at verse 25 again, it says, "Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members of one another." All right, so here's the contrast again. There's a negative trait and a positive command. All right, the negative trait is falsehood. So you circle the word falsehood. Circle the word falsehood, and then circle the word truth, because that's the positive command, and they're completely opposite. They're completely different. This is the contrast. Now, the first negative trait, the first don't, is falsehood. In other words, to put it more bluntly, it is lying. It is lying. You know, recently I heard about a woman who was pulled over by a police officer. And when he came up to her, she said to him, she rolled down her window, and she said to him, "Is there a problem, officer?" And she says, "Yes, you were speeding." She says, "I was speeding." She says, "Yes, you were speeding." He says, "May I see your driver's license?" And so she said to the officer, "Well, I'm sorry, but I don't have a driver's license." He said, "You don't have a driver's license?" He said, "No, I don't have a driver's license." He said, "Why don't you have a driver's license?" He says, "Oh, because it was taken away from me when I was convicted of drunk driving." He says, "Well, let me see your car vehicle registration." She says, "Well, I don't have a vehicle registration." He said, "You don't have a vehicle registration?" He said, "Why don't you have vehicle registration?" He said, "Because this is not my car. I stole this car. And when I stole this car, I killed the owner of the car, and I chopped up his body, put it in a plastic bag, and it's in the trunk. Would you like to see it?" At which, when the officer heard this, started to back away from the car. He said, "Okay." And he backed away and went to his patrol car and immediately called up for backup. Within a couple minutes, five police cars descended on the scene, surrounded the car. And then the sergeant, the supervisor, got out of the car, and he pulled out his service revolver, and he approached the car, and he said, "Ma'am, you need to step out of the car right now." And so she stepped out of the car and she said, yeah, "Is there a problem?" He says, "Yes, I understand. My officer tells me that you don't own this car and that you murdered the owner of this car and you cut up his body and his body is in the trunk of this car. I'd like for you to open up the trunk of the car." And she said, "Well, sir, sure, officer." And so she opens up the trunk of the car and it's empty. And he said, "Well, that's strange." He says, "My officer told me that you don't have a driver's license." She says, "Oh, no, no." She says, "Let me get my purse." So she gets her purse, pulls out a driver's license. "Here's my driver's license." And the officer's like, "Hey, this is weird." And he says, "My officer told me that you don't own this car, that this is somebody else's car, that you stole this car." She said, "Oh, no, no, let me get the vehicle registration." So she went to the glove box in the car, and she opened it up, and she got the vehicle registration. She says, "Here's my vehicle registration." And the sergeant was scratching his head, says, "You know, this is really strange. My officer told me that this wasn't your car, that you stole the car, that you killed the owner of the car, put his body in the trunk of the car, and that you didn't have a driver's license." And she said to him, "I suppose he also told you that I was speeding." hey, whatever you do, the next time you get pulled over, do not use that one, all right? Do not use that one, because if you do, you would be lying. You would be lying because it's not the truth, right? Proverbs 12:22. Why shouldn't we lie? Proverbs 12:22 says this: lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who act faithfully are his delight. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. Take a look at Proverbs 6:16-17. It says here, there are six things that the Lord hates. Six things that the Lord hates. Seven that are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue. Second one, a lying tongue. See, it is an abomination to God when we lie, right? God hates it when we lie. He absolutely disdains it when we are deceptive and when we even tell a white lie, something very simple. Do you know why? Because lying is what the devil does. That's what the devil does. From the beginning of time, all that Satan has ever done is to lie. He lied to Eve. He's lied about God. He's lied about Jesus. He's lied about sin. He's lied about heaven. He lied about hell. He's lied about everything on the face of the earth. Everything. That's who the devil is. In fact, because he is such a liar, Jesus gave him a special designation. Take a look at John 8:44. Here's what Jesus said about the devil. Gave him the name, gave him a special name, a special designation. Verse 44, Jesus said, "You are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires." He was a murderer from the beginning, so he's a murderer, and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. And when he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. You underline father of lies. You see, the devil is the father of lies. And that's why when we lie, we are just like the devil, which is why God hates it when we lie. Because when we lie, no matter what kind of a lie it is, even if it's a little white lie, we are behaving just like the devil behaves. And that's why God hates it. And that's why he says here, lay aside falsehood. It's not becoming of a Christ follower to lie in any way, shape, or form. And that's a negative trait, all right? That's the first negative trait. Now, the positive command that follows this, that is in contrast to the negative trait here, is that we need to speak the truth, all right? Speak the truth. And the word speak there is a verb. But not only is it written in the imperative mood, which makes it a command, it's not a suggestion, it's not a recommendation, it is a command. Not only is it in the imperative mood, but it's in the active voice. The verb is an active voice, and all that simply means is the action is continuous. It is continuous, which means we should constantly speak the truth. Never stop speaking the truth. Always speak the truth. That's the command. We're commanded to constantly be speaking the truth. That's the idea behind this particular verb. In other words, we got to keep telling the truth. And why are we to tell the truth? Remember, there's an explanation for every positive command. And the explanation is right here. It tells us, because we are members of one another. At the end of verse 25, we are members of one another. In other words, we belong to one another. We are family. And family never lies. A family should never lie to one another, because you're family. And we are a family here in this church. We are family, so we should never lie to one another. See, if you love somebody, you never lie to them. You always tell them the truth. Now, that doesn't mean you just let it all hang out and you just tell the truth with regard to how it's going to impact somebody. I mean, this verse is not a license for you to go out and go to somebody and say, "Pastor Gary said to tell the truth, so I'm going to tell you the truth. I'm going to let you have it. I think you're ugly. I think you smell. And I think you dress funny." You just don't say those kind of things, right? We need to remember what Paul said earlier in the chapter, verse 15, when Paul said, "Rather speaking the truth in love," right? We are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. We are to speak the truth in love. We always got to remember that love ought to drive everything. We speak the truth in love. So write this one down. The first negative trait is lying. The positive command is that we need to tell the truth. We need to tell the truth. This week, the world learned that the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, otherwise known as ISIS, beheaded an American journalist named James Foley. I hope you're all aware of this. You need to be aware of what's going on in the world today. A terrible thing. Foley's not the first American or person to be beheaded, and he won't be the last, unfortunately. And ISIS has overrun Syria, and it is about to overrun Iraq. And in the last month, they have massacred thousands of Christians, many more just this week, including women and children. I want to show you a photo of that I saw this week, and it is, and I just want to give you a heads up, this is, it is so hard to see, but I you need to see this so that you know exactly what's going on here. It's just absolutely tragic. But Randy, if you just put it up for just a second. You know, and that's good. I mean, ISIS epitomizes pure evil. And it's evil unlike I've ever seen in my lifetime. They are ruthless and barbaric, and they will slaughter anyone who does not convert to Islam. You know, and it reminds me, this behavior that we're seeing, in fact, all of the Sunday morning talk shows this morning led off with what's going on with ISIS and what they are doing and what we're going to do, what, if anything, our country is going to do about it. And, you know, this is just my personal opinion, so I'll just give you my personal opinion on this. This doesn't come from the scripture, but I believe their behavior perfectly mirrors that of the Antichrist. That's what I think. And Revelation 13:7 says that the Antichrist, I didn't write that down there for you, but you should read it. Revelation 13:7 says that the Antichrist will make war on the saints. And that's a literal quote. He will make war on the saints. And his armies will make war on the saints, the saints, that's you and me, right? Those are all believers. And that's what's happening right now. And what we are seeing, I believe, is ISIS is a forerunner to the Antichrist and the armies of the Antichrist and what will be taking place. And because we're seeing this take place even now, I believe that our time is very short. I really believe, that's again my opinion, I believe that time is very short. And that's why I believe that what we're doing here at South Bay Community Church is the most important thing that we as a church can do. And that's why it's important that every one of you gets engaged in this ministry, that you don't just attend church. And if it isn't our church, that's okay. But go to a church, go to a Bible-believing church and get involved in that church, because that is the most important thing that you could possibly ever do. And become a Christ follower and then get baptized, because I believe Christ is coming very, very soon. And I'm so thankful that as Christ followers, we don't have to experience this. We won't ever be put in a situation, well, I shouldn't say we won't ever, because I know that ISIS is threatening to come to America. But according to the scriptures, we will one day be taken out. The church will be taken out. We will be raptured so that we don't have to go through the great tribulation period when the Antichrist will rise to power and begin to slice off heads because people won't convert to his religion or whatever that religion is. And I'm glad that God's going to come and rescue us. But I wouldn't say that we might never experience that. I mean, the way I never imagined seeing something like this. But I don't know how you feel when you see images like this. I don't know how you feel. I can tell you how I feel. One of the emotions that rises up inside of me is anger. I mean, it just makes me angry. I mean, how can they do that to children? How can they behead, decapitate children? I don't understand that. And of course, there are other emotions as well, but that's the first one. And you know, most people associate anger with rage and with fury. You know, it's like when you get mad at something. And that's the second trait that Paul speaks about here. That's the second negative trait that he speaks about. You know, when we get angry, the problem with anger is that it can lead to all kinds of other issues and all kinds of other problems. I mean, anger dwelling up deep inside of us is why we will start saying the bad things that we say, why we will cuss and why we will vent and why we will rant and why we will go on a tirade and why we will chew somebody out. It's anger. And then, of course, if it stops there, that'd be great. That'd be bad enough. But then anger can go on. It goes on and it turns into road rage because somebody has cut you off, or it can turn into rioting and violence and destruction and looting and even murder. That's where anger leads. And that's the negative trend. He says, this is not something we need to be doing. We should not be angry. And that's, but here's the thing. In verse 26, when Paul wrote about anger, this was not the kind of anger he was talking about. Let me read it to you. It says, be angry and do not sin. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger and give no opportunity to the devil. Would you circle the word angry? The anger that is in this passage is not the anger that I just described. How it is not the anger that we often feel throughout the week. In the Greek, this word does not refer to some over-the-top rage or some inward seething resentment. Instead, this anger in the Greek refers to a deep-seated, determined, and settled conviction. That's literally what it means. It is a deep-seated, determined, settled conviction devoid of sin. It is absent of sin. Be angry and do not sin. Notice that? Be angry and do not sin. In other words, what Paul was talking about here was righteous anger. This is righteous anger. This was the kind of anger that Jesus felt when he cleared out the temple courtyard because the money changers had come in and they were doing all kinds of business. And he said, this is supposed to not, this is God's house. This is not where you transact business and sell all kinds of things. This is not the marketplace. And so Jesus came in and he swept everyone out because he was angry at that. That was righteous anger. He got angry without sinning. This is the type of anger that Jesus felt when he was teaching the Pharisees and he was teaching the people. And the Pharisees came in and there was a man with a withered hand and he came upon the scene and Jesus wanted to heal him, but it was the Sabbath. And the Pharisees, all they wanted to know is he going to heal him? Is he going to heal him on the Sabbath? Is he going to heal him on the Sabbath? And they didn't care a rip about this guy that he had a withered hand. And so Jesus was angry. Take a look at Mark 3:5. And it says, and he looked around at them with anger. I mean, this is Jesus getting angry. He looked at them with anger, grieved at their hardness of heart, and said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored. And Jesus didn't care about how they thought, you know, but Jesus was grieved at their hardness of heart. He was grieved at their sin, that they didn't care about this man, that he had a withered hand. They didn't care that he was handicapped in some way, that he had a physical disability. All they cared about was, is he going to heal him on the Sabbath or not? So this is the kind of anger that Paul was speaking about here. This is righteous anger. This is when you get angry about sin. This is when you get angry about someone's stubbornness. This is when you get angry at the devil because of all that he is doing in the world. So write this one down. This is the second negative trait. The second negative trait, this is the don't, and that's anger. Don't get angry. And the positive command that accompanies it is be angry, but don't sin. Be angry, but don't sin. And I hope you see the contrast. On the one hand, there is anger. On the other hand, there is righteous anger. On one hand, there is anger, and it's rage and it's fury. And on the other hand, it's anger that does not sin. It is anger that is rooted in righteousness. It is anger only at evil. It is anger only at what is wrong in this world. And why should we obey the positive command? Man, there's an explanation for every that accompanies every positive command, right? And it's found in verse 27, and it says, it's because we don't want to give the devil an opportunity. Don't give the devil an opportunity. You see, we don't want to give the devil a foothold in our lives, and that's what can happen when you don't check your anger in at the door. Even righteous anger can easily turn into something very bad, very negative. I mean, you can be, oh, I'm so mad at what they did, and then you just go out and you get a gun and you shoot somebody. That's giving the devil an opportunity. And that's why Paul said you need to not let the sun go down on your anger. In other words, you got to deal with your anger. If you're an angry person, you need to deal with your anger. You don't want to go to sleep with it. If you go to sleep with it, you'll wake up with it. So he said, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Deal with it. If you're angry at your boss, if you're angry at your spouse, if you're angry at your kids, if you're angry at your parents, at your brothers or sisters, get rid of it. Because otherwise it can destroy you. And there's only one anger that's justified, and that's righteous anger. And it's very difficult for us because we're not righteous people. It's very difficult for us to have a righteous anger. If you're following God and you're really close to God and you're really tied with God and you're constantly in his will, then you can get angry at evil, and that's righteous anger, and that's good. But so often we can't even do that. You know, about 10 years ago, I had an experience here at church that really baffled me. And I've shared this story with only a few people, and this weekend, yesterday, and of course today, is the first time that I'm sharing this story publicly with all of you. And it was the most baffling experience I've ever had at this church. It was about 10 years ago. We were meeting at our old location on 190th Street, just down the street across from Office Depot. We had a place there, and that's where we were meeting. And something happened there that I want to tell you about. In addition to being a Star Wars fan, I became a Lord of the Rings fan. You know, and I get into these movies, and I thought, oh, man, it's so cool. I'm not into Twilight and all that other stuff, but Lord of the Rings is really cool, and I loved all that stuff, and so Tolkien and all that kind of stuff. And so one day, I love this stuff, and I thought, man, one day I found out about all, I saw these swords, right, that they're fighting with all these swords, and you know, like lightsabers, and so I thought, that's really cool. And so I decided to buy a replica of Gandalf's sword. In fact, this is Gandalf, and that's a sword he used, you know. You shall not pass. And I just love that. I love that sword, and I thought, that's such a cool sword. So, and I found the replica on I don't know if it was on eBay or someplace, but I found it, and I thought, I'm going to buy that sword. I didn't get permission from my wife. If I did, she would have said no. So I didn't get permission. I just bought it, and it was so cool. I mean, it was made out of steel. I mean, super heavy. Drew, you've seen it. It's super heavy, and it is really pointy, sharp. I mean, you could do some damage with that thing. It is just really neat, and I love that sword almost as much as my lightsaber. Well, one day, I decided to use my sword and to make an illustration in my message at church. And so I brought it to church, and I said, you know, in fact, I used the scripture in the Proverbs that says that our tongue is like a sword, and it can cut people up, right? So I held the sword up like this, and it could cut people up, right? And so I brought the sword to church, and then when the service was done, I had to rush off to the office. Our offices were on Amapola. Remember, you all know where Amapola is at. So I had to go there because I think I was teaching a discovery class. And so I got to the office, and I realized, oh, I forgot my sword. And so I called a friend, somebody in our church who was still at the church, and I said, hey, are you still at church? And he says, yeah. He says, hey, I forgot my sword. Would you just bring my sword to the office for me? He said, yeah, okay, no problem. I'll get it. I said, I told him exactly where it was. He said, okay, yeah, I'll bring it. And so he showed up a short while later. He showed up, and I'm teaching the class, and I'm thinking, of course, did he bring my sword? Did he bring my sword? And so during the break, I said, hey, did you bring my sword? He says, no, I couldn't find it. I go, you couldn't find it? I told you it was, you know, right where, by the sound booth, et cetera, and he said, wow, I couldn't find it. I said, you're kidding me. So, like, you know, I'm trying to rush through the class, and as soon as the class is done, I head back to the office, and I head back to the church, and I start looking for my sword, and I'm like, you know, where's my sword? Where's my sword? And I'm looking all by the sound booth, and I'm looking on the stage, I'm looking all over the place, I'm looking around, all checking all the rooms, checking the closet, where's my sword? And I can't find my sword. It's like, that is so, my sword. I mean, like, you know, I spent a lot of money on that sword. It's like, I love that sword. Where's my sword? And finally, nothing. And so I found out who was here. You know, who was here when we were closing up. So I got the names of everybody. I called everybody, emailed, I said, hey, did you see my sword? Did you see my sword? Everybody came back and said, no, I didn't see your sword. Didn't see your sword. I said, you're kidding. Where's my sword? Right? A week later, I get this cryptic handwritten note. And it says, hello, I am your sword. And I'm on a little journey. And I will see you very soon. And I thought, what? And I'm not kidding you. A cryptic handwritten note. I am your sword, and I am on a little journey, and I will see you. And I thought, okay, someone's playing with me. And okay, that's, you know, I can go along with that. And so I figured the sword would show up, you know, within a couple days, right? A week passed, nothing. 2 weeks passed, nothing. 3 weeks passed, nothing. Not a peep. No more follow-up notes. No more follow-up emails. No word. Nothing. A whole month passed, complete silence. 2 months pass, nothing. 4 months pass, nothing. By this time, you know, I'm like, you know, like, what is going on here, right? What is going on? And I couldn't understand what was going on. And it wasn't funny to me anymore. 6 months, 9 months, finally a year later, somebody was on the stage, cleaning the stage. I think that they were moving the drum kits or, you know, one of the sound guys, they were doing some work back here. Well, back at the old place, we had this wall, and we had a huge big wall, and we had a projector screen on the wall. Because, you know, now we got smart. We thought, why spend money for a projector screen? We just got white paint and painted the walls. And so that's our projector screen. And back then, we had a projector screen. And so someone was back there, and they happened to just pull out this projector screen a little bit and look behind the projector screen and thought, oh, hey, there's something up there. What is that? You know, what is that? And they turned on the lights and looked a little bit more and said, hey, that's a sword. What is that? It's a sword. So it turns out it was my sword. Hey, Pastor Gary, come here. There's something up here. And we rolled up the screen, and there was my sword hanging on about 20 feet up, 18 feet up. There was my sword. Somebody had mounted the sword and put it on the back wall. And I said, what is that? That's my sword. I said, well, let's get it down. I said, no, you can leave it up there. No, we'll get it. It's your sword. You can't leave it up there. We'll get it down. You know, all right. So they got it down, and they said, here's your sword. And they gave me the sword, and you know what? I didn't even want it. You know, I didn't even want it. I held it. I said, it doesn't feel the same. I don't want it. You know, I don't want it. No, well, it's your sword. You know, and it was really strange, and this is really true. But I had felt violated. It's kind of like, I don't know if you've ever had a car stolen, and if somebody steals your car and the police say, you know, oh, we found your car. You know, you'd almost rather say, just total it. I don't even want it. I don't even want the car. I don't even, because somebody's been in and gone through all my stuff, and that's kind of how I felt. You know, I felt like somebody took this thing, and that's why I haven't shared it all these years. It's been 10 years now. Somebody took the sword and just, something that didn't belong, and they just kept it for all this time. And, you know, I never got a note. I never got an apology. No one ever came up to me and said, you know, I'm so sorry. This is your sword. I should have given it back to you. So, you know, Carrie, you know, thank you for apologizing. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, and so it was really, like I say, it was a really baffling experience. But it felt to me like it had been stolen from me, taken from me. And, you know, that's the issue that Paul addresses here next in verse 28. And here's what he said. He said, let the thief no longer steal. All right, circle the word steal. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his own hands, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need. You know, the Greek word for the word steal is the word klepto. It's where we get the word kleptomaniac, right? Kleptomaniac. See, stealing is a negative trait. You know, whether you're taking paper clips at the office, whether you're cheating at school on a test, where you're copying somebody else's term paper, whether you're cheating on your taxes, I mean, it is not becoming of a Christ follower to steal. It is the negative trait. Now, the contrast here, it says, but rather, notice that's the contrast, but rather, let him labor. The word labor there, you can circle the word labor, is a verb. It is a positive command. In other words, we are commanded to work. We are commanded to work. And notice it says we are to do honest work, right? We are to do honest work. Every once in a while I mentioned this last night, but every once in a while I hear, oh, I'm getting paid under the table. You know, that's not honest work, to be really honest with you. Oh, cash under the table. Oh, you're just going to pay me cash. And that's not honest work, right? Because we ought to report what God gives to us and what God blesses us with, right? Honest work is a stark contrast to stealing. And there's nothing honest about stealing. So write this one down. Stealing is the negative trait here. And working honestly is the positive command. It is the positive command. And the explanation for the positive command, remember there's an explanation for every positive command, so I'm found at the end of verse 28, and it's this, so that he may have something to share with anyone in need, right? The reason you ought to work is so that you might have an income, and that income is not just for you. That income is not something that you should be selfish about. Oh, look at all this money I got. No, this, it says here, we ought to share our income. We ought to share what God has given to us with others, especially to someone who has a need. So share with others. You can share with me if you'd like. All right? So that's stealing and honest work. Those are the contrasts right there. All right? Number four. This is Pastor Mark Driscoll. Pastor Mark pastors a very large church in Seattle, Washington. He has been dubbed, get this, he has been dubbed the cussing pastor. The cussing pastor, because over the years he has earned a reputation as being a foul-mouthed man of the cloth. And although I've heard he's toned it down recently, what a title, right? On one occasion, he was invited to speak at a church in Arlington, Texas, just outside of Dallas, called Access Church. And when he got there, it was explained to him that swearing from the pulpit is not something that will fly in Texas, in the Bible Belt. So he was asked to keep his language clean. When Driscoll ascended the stage and took the pulpit to speak, he dropped the F-bomb in the very first sentence of his message. Can you believe that? Wow. Pastor. Driscoll represents a new breed of pastors who believe that they can't minister effectively unless they speak the language of contemporary counterculture. We got to relate, you know. We got to be real. So we're going to speak this language. We're going to use the F-bomb and the S-word and the B-word and all those other words in church because that makes us real. See, what they fail to understand is where this kind of talk comes from. They don't get it. They don't understand where this talk comes from. Here's what Jesus said where this talk comes from. Take a look at Matthew 15, verse 18. It says, Jesus said, but what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the what? The heart. What comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this defiles a person. You see, what comes out of your mouth is a reflection of what is in your heart. That's what Jesus said. So if you spew forth profanity, if you cuss, if you talk dirty, if you are always critical, if you're constantly tearing down people, if you're a gossiper, that is a reflection of what is in your heart. That's what Jesus said. And so when a pastor or anyone else speaks like that, it is a reflection of what is in our hearts. And that's the negative trait that Paul wrote about here in verse 29. He said, "Let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear." Will you circle the word corrupting? And then circle the word building up. Here's the contrast again, right? One negative, one positive. One do, one don't. First of all, corrupting talk. This is what we shouldn't do. Corrupting talk in the Greek means rank or foul or putrid or rotten or disgusting. Don't let rotten words, disgusting words, putrid words, foul words, rank words come out of your mouth. Any kind of it. The NIV Bible translates it this way: do not let any unwholesome talk, and I like that word, unwholesome talk, come out of your mouths. I like that word, kind of an all-encompassing word, unwholesome talk. Unwholesome talk is negative talk. It is not becoming of a Christ follower. And the contrast is the positive command, and that is that we need to speak words that build up. We need to speak words that build up. And the word building up, oikodomeo, it comes from the word house. We need to build up the house, means to edify. And in other words, it means we need to speak, well, what do? We speak constructively. We speak words of encouragement. We need to speak to each other with words that lift up, that build up. That's wholesome words. That is the contrast, all right? So you can write that one down. The positive, the negative trait, unwholesome words. The positive command, that we need to speak wholesome words. Unwholesome and wholesome, right? And why are we to speak wholesome words instead of unwholesome words? Well, here's the explanation, verse 30. "And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption." Here's the explanation. Why should we speak, why do we need to speak wholesome words versus unwholesome words? Because unwholesome words grieve the Holy Spirit. Did you know that when you become a Christ follower, when you ask Christ to come into your heart, he literally comes into your heart, and the Holy Spirit of God, the Spirit of God, comes into your heart. And now you become the temple of the Holy Spirit, the temple of God. You are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God lives inside of you. So can you imagine the Spirit of God living inside of you, and you got all this junk in there, and all this junk is coming out? And whenever there's junk coming out of our hearts, it grieves the Holy Spirit. Like, oh my, you know, I can imagine the Holy Spirit saying, "Oh my gosh, I can't believe you said that. Oh, it just kills me. It kills me that you were saying those things. It kills me that you're looking at that stuff. It kills me that you're thinking these things," right? Grieves the Holy Spirit. And rather than grieving the Holy Spirit, you know, God wants our lives to be a reflection of who he is inside of us instead of the sin that is inside of us. And so that's why we are to speak wholesome words instead of unwholesome words. Well, finally, we arrive at the end of chapter 4, verse 31. Let me take a look at verse 31. It says, "Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice." All right, you can stop there. There are six negative traits here, six negative characteristics. Bitterness, we need to put aside bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, slander, and malice. And I took all these words, just for the sake of presenting it to you, I just grouped them all in one category. And that category, I called it hostility. These are all hostile actions. These are all hostile attitudes. People who are bitter are hostile. People who are wrathful and angry, they're hostile. People who clamor, the word clamor here refers to public outcries, protests, loss of control. They are hostile. People who slander and who speak maliciously are hostile. And you know people like that. And you don't want to be around people like that. They are not nice to be people to be around. And it is not becoming of a, especially of a Christ follower. I can understand that the world is like that. But people in the church should not be like that. You shouldn't be hostile. My daughter, Kylie, works at a local restaurant here. And she said that there is one particular customer who comes in, and she is absolutely hostile. Every time she comes in, everyone says, "Oh no, there she is again. You handle her. You know, you talk to her. You take her order. You don't." No one wants to deal with her because she is so hostile. And my daughter says, "We make sure to double check and triple check and quadruple check her order, because if we get her order wrong, she goes looking for the boss." And she says, "She is so hostile. She is so mean. She is so just unpleasant to be around." And so you know people like that. And we are not to be that way. We are not to be that way at all. Whether you're working, or whether you're at home, or whether you're here, whether you're on the road, doesn't matter. That's not becoming of a Christ follower. And so here's the positive command. What are we to do instead? And what are we to do instead? Instead of being wrathful and bitter and angry and clamorous and slanderous and malicious. Verse 32. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another. Right? We're to be kind to one another. We're to be tenderhearted. That's the positive command. So it's kindness. It's tenderheartedness. It's forgiveness. That's how we are to live. Right? And they're, as you can see, they're the complete opposite of the hostile attributes I just shared with you. Right? So the negative trait here, just for the sake of condensing it, is hostility. You can write that one down, or it's written down there for you. The positive command is kindness, tenderheartedness, and forgiveness. And why should we be tenderhearted? Why should we be forgiving? Why should we be kind? Verse, here's the explanation. At the end of verse 32, it tells us, because God in Christ forgave you. Right? The explanation for the positive command, why we should be kind, is because God was kind to us. And more specifically, it's about forgiveness. But why should we be tenderhearted? It's because God is tenderhearted. Why should we be forgiving? It's because God forgave us. And that's why we're to forgive, right? That's why we're to live out these attributes. So let me ask you something. What would happen if we all just stopped lying to each other? What would happen if we just started telling the truth and love to one another? What would happen if we just stopped being angry and stop being wrathful? What would happen if we stop stealing from one another? What happens if we stop speaking corrupt words? What happens if we stop the bitterness and the wrath and the clamor and the slander and the malice? What would happen if instead we started telling the truth? What would happen if we started getting angry only when we were angry about evil and our anger was righteous anger? What would happen if we just worked honestly and shared what God gave us? And if we only spoke wholesome words that built people up, and you spoke words that were just constantly edifying and constantly encouraging and constantly lifting people up, what would happen if we were always kind and tender-hearted and forgiving? Well, I think what would happen is that we wouldn't be like the rest of the world, but that we would be like the people that God created us to be. That's what would happen. You and I, we would be the church, that we would be the people that God created us to be. And it would be a vastly different world. We would be a little light in the corner of our world. And that's how I understand James Foley lived his life. Here he is on the battlefront. He was a reporter, a photojournalist, I understand. There's a lot of information coming about him this week, because he was just murdered. He was a man of deep faith. Everyone who knew him said that he cared deeply about the injustices and evil that were being perpetrated upon the people in Syria, which is why he felt that he needed to be in Syria, reporting on what was going on in Syria so that the world would know what was going on in Syria. That's why he was there. He had a righteous anger. He himself had been taken hostage by terrorists when he was in Libya just a few years ago. But unfortunately, he was released at that time, and as soon as he was released, he went right back into Syria because he cared about those people. We're learning that when he was in the hands of ISIS, he was captured, I believe, by ISIS in 2012. We're learning that he was brutally tortured. He was tortured more than anyone else because his captors found out that he had a brother in the military, and so they decided to torture him even more. And at one point, it was reported that he was even crucified. They crucified him on the prison wall. I mean, just nailed to the prison wall is what they did to him. His brother said this week that he was a man of courage. His friend said that he was a man of compassion. His mom said that they received word from other captives who had been set free about how their son had helped them while they were in prison together. This is his mom and dad speaking to the reporters this week. Mrs. Foley said, quote, in the midst of his suffering, he was helping other prisoners. There were a couple of much younger people in that cell. Jim was one of the much older ones, and he would hold one of them, we were told, who was struggling. So here's this guy. He's suffering the same thing that everybody else is, and there's this one kid, a much younger prisoner, who just cannot handle it. And so Jim just goes there and just wraps his arms around him, just gives him a bear hug, and just holds him and holds him because it's so difficult. And I wouldn't be surprised if James Foley even forgave his killers because God forgave him. See, what would happen if we stripped off the negative traits and didn't do the don'ts and we did the do's and we lived the positive commands that Paul spoke of? Yeah, we would be that light, wouldn't we? We'd be that light in a little corner of our world. In this world of darkness, you would be a light. In your dark school, you would be a light. In your dark workplace, you would be a light. In your family, where maybe you're the only believer, you would be a light. We'd be a light just like Jim Foley. And that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. So what if you've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, but you don't live it? So what if you've been chosen and adopted and redeemed and sealed and forgiven and saved and lavished with grace and on and on and on, but you don't live it? Let's live it, beloved. Let's live it. Let's take these positive commands to heart. Make them a part of our lives so that we can be a light. Let's be a light together. Amen? All right, let's close in prayer. Father, boy, so many things racing through our minds and hearts. We truly live in a very dark world. But Father God, you've given us so much hope in Jesus Christ. I mean, where would we be? Where would any of us be today if we didn't have you to turn to? Father, thank you for these profound and life-changing words spoken by Paul, who himself was martyred for his faith. Father, will you help us to take everything that we learned here to heart, that we would become people who speak the truth and who speak words that only build up, people who are never angry unless it's about evil, and then we don't let the devil have an opportunity because we don't let the sun go down on our anger. And will you help us to be people who are kind and tenderhearted and forgiving even against those who would harm us, like James Foley? Father, will you be with his family? Will you comfort them? Will you strengthen them? And Father, for all of our brothers and sisters in Iraq and Syria and elsewhere in Nigeria, where they are being slain for their faith because they refuse to convert to Islam, will you strengthen them? Will you strengthen them, Father, in their faith, that they will not turn away from you? Father, will you intervene in their lives that they could perhaps be spared? We don't know how. Father, will you do whatever it takes? Will you rescue your people? We cry out to you for them and for their lives. Stop this madness, Father. Stop this evil. We turn to you. We ask, God, for your blessings. I don't know who that little baby was. Father, I pray that that baby's still alive. I pray that you would protect all the babies, all the children, all the women, all the men there from this evil. And Father, help us. We are helpless in many ways, but we aren't helpless because we can pray to the God of God and the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Will you help us as we go from here to be a light in our little corner of the world? Help us to let our lights shine so brightly because we are living out these positive commands. Thank you, Father. We need your help. Can't do it without you. Bless us, Father. I ask this in Jesus' name.